Assalamu alaikum, jamian.
Thank you so much all for joining. My
name is Souad Jamal AlSerkal. I am the Vice President of Strategic Communications at Tabreed. We are a company, a district cooling company based in Abu Dhabi. With me today, I am so excited to have Sir Martin.
Don't get too excited, Souad. Don't get too. And you won't be disappointed. So just keep the level of excitement down.
So, I still am. I have Sir Martin Sorrell. He's the founder and executive chairman of S4 Capital, founder of WPP from the United Kingdom. How are you, Sir Martin?
I'm very well. I hope you're well. And I should wish you long life, as you know.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So today we are... going to be talking about climate and how serious it is. If you didn't read what we're talking about, so during the pandemic, the power of persuading the citizens to follow the rules and guidelines for safe behaviors and has basically become a very, very key factor in containing the contagion. How can we apply the lessons that we learned to the challenge of climate change and sustainability is the biggest question. So, I mean, you're here because you are an expert and you have something to share with us. How can we apply the lessons that we learned from the pandemic about how to persuade the population to change the behavior to the challenge of climate change and sustainability?
Well, delighted to be with you, Souad, and with anybody who may or may not be listening or watching. And anybody wants to discuss this, my email address is martin@s4capital.com, and we can talk about it afterwards because we've only got 10 minutes or less than 10 minutes now. But having said that, I think it sort of splits, so in, as you and I were talking in the green room before we came on air, into two phases. I think the first phase, when most governments, if not all, and we can discuss that as well, were caught out, obviously, this was a black swan. If a black swan, I think black swans are unknown unknowns. So this was a known unknown because we had people like Bill Gates telling us at TED conferences that a pandemic might happen. In fact, President Trump did have a report on pandemics, but it was more from a terrorist angle. I think there was report was delivered to him in 2018. And the British government had been prepared in 2016. And ironically, I think the Singaporean government snaffled the plan and they implemented and the UK government didn't implement. So basically most governments were caught completely unawares. I mean, we know that Davos was caught unawares. There were no sessions at Davos at the end of January of last year. I think there were two sessions on pandemics. So even though it had already started in Wuhan and was fanning out, governments were really caught, if I can put it this way, with their trousers down. And, you know, if I take the UK as an example, I mean, my experience really is confined to the UK and the US, although I've been in South America recently in Uruguay, and the Uruguayans actually did a very good job shutting down their borders. But I think the key thing was to respond quickly with a lockdown. I mean, you and I were talking about Vietnam, 90 million people. The incidence of the virus is very limited. And the reason was that they shut down very quickly and people obeyed the government in terms of the lockdown and masking. So when you look for communications lessons, I think you can split it into two phases. Phase one, where I think politicians, governors, mayors, prime ministers, presidents were looking to make political capital or to build their political capital and relied, I think, on mass media and mass communication, which was probably necessary at the time. But I think a lot of that was relatively ineffective. And what I noticed was that in phase one, we really didn't get very effective campaigns, either in terms of discipline in many of the Western economies. Maybe China is different, given the nature of its regime. Vietnam is certainly different. In phase one, I think mass communication was relatively ineffective. Now, just talking from personal experience, I was in South America. I came back to the UK. I've been self-isolating. and I will get the vaccination. I'm over 75 and I have an underlying condition, type 2 diabetes. So I you know, the government here has vaccinated people over 80 years old first and frontline workers. And I think the interesting thing about communication in phase two, if I can put it like that, is it's become much more personalized. So, for example, since being back in the UK, I am literally bombarded with text messages and phone calls. And of course, you know, the police are probably more active even in a UK context than they were in the first wave. So I think governments have learned and administrations have learned over the period. So I'd split it into two phases. Phase one, much more mass communication, limited test and trace, very ineffective, well, not very ineffective, generally ineffective systems around test and trace. And then as governments came under greater pressure from their electorates, and as the second waves and third waves have kicked in, much more effective. And the vaccination phase here, for example, in the UK, looks as though, I'm tempting providence here, because we have the mutant strains of the virus, but this second phase looks as though it's going to be pretty effective. I mean, interestingly, this morning, a lot of the media comment here was whether Boris Johnson will gain political capital. He lost political capital quite clearly in the early phases of this, but whether with a rolled-out vaccine, you know, I think they're talking now about 300,000 people being vaccinated a day. So it was a million a week, and it's now, it seems, it sounds though it might be greater than that. So I think the lesson is, you know, and I'm speaking my own book here, that personalized communication, digitally personalized communication, content that is tailored to deal with the challenge, delivered personally, algorithmically, with feedback from the individual in a continuous loop. So what we call the Holy Trinity model, that becomes a model that has become even more effective during these difficult times.
You said something very, very important when you talk about feedback. The reason I think, in my humble opinion, that people don't deal with climate change as serious as they are dealing with the pandemic right now is because there's nothing tangible to them at the moment that they can say, okay, fine, so this is happening, I need to react to it accordingly. When we're talking about the COVID, what is the reaction? Someone got sick, let's get into quarantine, let's do this, let's do that, because it's very apparent. But when we're talking about climate change, we talk about, let's fix now for the future. So the people now are not worried about the now, but we need to put into consideration what we need to do for the future. So when we talk about the lesson learned today, how do you think the packaging, I would say, because you said personalized, so the packaging of the information and then the feedback, what could we take from the situation right now to make it more personalized for people to actually take action instead of just listening?
It is difficult because people in positions of power and authority and influence don't take it seriously. You know, we've had an administration in the United States for 4 years that clearly didn't. And we've immediately seen, even before President-elect Biden takes control midday on tomorrow in Washington, he is already implementing measures to deal with climate change. And clearly that will be front and center, whether it's the Paris Accord, whether it's pipelines, whatever it happens to be. Clearly, having people in control of administrations, you really take it seriously, is going to make a difference. But, you know, coming back to your point about personal, you know, the extremes of climate which we're all being subjected to, and of course there is a strain of academic view and authoritative view that says climate change is not an issue. So you have to deal with that. You have to deal with the evidence. But, you know, we are having more and more evidence, whether it be, you know, whether it be climate change and its impact on poles, North and South Pole, or on floods or tsunamis or storms or whatever it happens to be. We are seeing that at a personal level more and more. So I think that personal impact, Souad, is becoming greater and greater. But the key thing is going to be whether in the Western world it changes as a result of change administration. in the Eastern world, I mean, the Chinese, to be fair, have embraced it. There are a lot of cynics who believe that it's more sort of jaw-jaw than war-war, if I can put it like that, or more talk than action. My own view is that the Chinese are taking it seriously and they will implement it. Some people believe that, you know, it won't be the end of coal-burning plants in China. Yeah. I'm not so sure. I think the Chinese are making big inroads into the green agenda, into the climate change agenda, and we will see a change. But, you know, I think the shift in the US administration is going to be very significant in making people understand the implications. So all is not lost, Souad.
Definitely. All is not lost. I mean, we ran out of time, and I wish that we had more. Again, my name is Souad Jamal AlSerkal. I'm the Vice President of Communications at Tabreed. With me was Sir Martin Sorrell, the Chairman of S4 Capital. Again, your email is martin@s4capital.com.
Yeah.
S4capital.com. So if you guys need to connect with him, please do. Thank you so much for being with us.
I hope we can keep in touch.
Definitely. Take care, everyone.
Thank you. God bless.